And the analysis of Shields and Brooks. That is syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. Welcome, gentlemen. So the first debate among, David, 10 of the 17 Republicans running for president last night. What's your assessment?
It was great. It was a great debate. Trump brings the party, and I hope he stays. Maybe in the general they can stick him in, because I thought he livens the atmosphere. I mean, he's not a real candidate. No, he's not. He doesn't have an ideology. He doesn't have a belief system. He has himself. And they went after him, the three excellent moderators, and he defended himself, and I think he did fine. Probably 70% of Republicans disapprove of him. A lot of the things he said were astonishingly inappropriate. That he wouldn't support the Republican nominee, that's kind of a big one. He likes single-payer health system. That's the first Republican that sort of likes that. So he's outside all the categories. But he is a lord of self-esteem. And his main message is society is filled with losers, and they happen to be running it. And society has some winners who are being ignored. And if you're a winner like me, we got to get rid of those losers. And that's an ideology that's not a political ideology. It's a narcissistic ideology. But I suspect the 20% who like him will continue to like him and like him even more. And so he'll be hanging around there. Among the real candidates, I thought Rubio did quite well. Carly Fiorina in the under debate did quite well, and John Kasich did quite well. And so I think those three helped themselves, and they actually are viable candidates and make us rethink the race.
How do you size it up, Mark?
I don't know where to agree. No, I agree. Donald Trump fills up the hall. I mean, there were 24 million people who watched. That's more people than had ever watched a cable other than a sports event. And this was a sports event. Donald Trump indicated right at the outset he's going to run as Donald Trump. And I thought it was an indication of the magic he's established, the chemistry he has with Republican voters, that the only person on the stage and a candidate who would even take a shot at him was Rand Paul. All the others ducked him. John Kasich included, Jeb Bush included, when given opportunities. So who went after him? The three Fox moderators who were tough. They really did. And I really think he made a serious mistake by going, retaliating, attacking Megyn Kelly. First of all,
when she asked him about his comments
about women, his misogynist comments. First of all, Fox News is the validator. It's the gatekeeper for Republican, particularly conservative voters. And you don't go after, it isn't like you're attacking Chuck Todd or Judy Woodruff or some member of the liberal elite establishment. You're attacking the mother church.
Well,
when you go
let's
after
make
Fox.
A distinction here.
Okay, no, but I mean, but seriously, I mean, no, but I'm
not part of the liberal.
No, I'm talking about by the definition of conservative America, where Fox really is the gatekeeper. I think you'd agree, the gatekeeper and the validator. And when he went after her, I think he made a serious mistake. I thought, as far as the others were concerned.
So you don't think he helped him?
I think he hurt himself. I really do. He's a combination, quite unlike anything I've ever seen before. I agree partially with David that it's sort of egotism and cynicism. Everything is transactional. You believe nothing. Why do you give money to Democrats? You give money to Democrats because you're going to give them a call and they're going to do what you want. Everything. There's no idea. John Kennedy said he was an idealist without illusions. Donald Trump is a cynic without illusions. And so, you know, nothing's on the level. You go into bankruptcy four times. You screw the investors. Hey, that's the way it's done. And so I thought he came across really by having taken on Fox News and particularly Chris Wallace and Bret Baier and particularly Megyn Kelly. I think he made a mistake.
But you said, David, a minute ago, you thought Marco Rubio did well, and you thought John Kasich did well. What stood out?
Yeah, so Rubio has a message. The message is America's changing fast. I'm surrounded by a bunch of old guys who don't get it, and I get it. I get Amazon. I get Airbnb. That's actually a pretty good message, and it goes with his belief system, and he presents very well. And he's very articulate and well-spoken and smart. And so he has a message. Kasich has a different message, which is unique and I think reflective also of the times, which is we need growth, but we need compassion. And so he defends some of the New Deal social, even the Great Society social programs, but he said we got to grow, and then once we grow, we got to share. And early in the program, we had his passage on going to a marriage with a gay friend. And so that's a broadening message. That's actually a general election message. And Rubio also has a general election message. And so if you're a Republican mainstreamer, and you're trying to think who can win, Well, walking in, you thought, well, Jeb Bush appeals to a lot of people. And we all go around the country and we hear a lot of people who are not particularly political, but they think, Jeb Bush, he seems acceptable. He was meh at the debate. He was fine, but not terrible, not great. But these two guys have something new and something that actually could be viable. And, you know, Florida and Ohio, if those two run a ticket, you're doing okay.
So, Mark, but you see some delineation. I mean, there's now some more separation between these candidates as a result of this debate.
Yeah, no, there wasn't. Nobody's called in. I will say the person who probably had the best night was Carly Farina. Mark Russell, the
political... Who was on earlier. She wasn't even in the...
She was on the early one, and Mark Russell, the great satirist, said, who won the 5 o'clock debate? Carly Farina. Who won the 9 o'clock debate? Carly Farina. I think she represents something Republicans need. They want her on that stage, because when she goes after Hillary Clinton, again, we can't be accused of misogyny if it's a woman doing it, and she does it quite effectively. I thought Marco Rubio had a good night. Marco Rubio plays better to the punditocracy, those of us who cover it, than he has directly to voters. His numbers have not been great. He doesn't seem to have a base, but he really, I thought he handled himself quite well last night. I was not as impressed as David and others were with John Kasich, because he was given the opportunity by Chris Wallace after Donald Trump made this outrageous statement about Mexico, the government is sending criminals across the border. And Chris Wallace asked him for any evidence. He had no evidence. He said, I was at the Border Patrol, had a visit to Laredo. And he said, what about that? He said, no, we're doing it because American politicians and leaders are dumb and the Mexican government's smart and they're sticking us with a bill. And he turns to John Kasich. He said, what about that, Governor? And John Kasich says, Donald Trump has touched into something in America. I mean, instead of confronting him, I thought that Rubio had a good night. And Jeb Bush was wallpaper. There was no sense of command to him.
Whoa, that's tough. Just quickly, if both of you think Fiorina had a good night, what does that say, though, about the system that's leaving the other seven, the people who don't make the cut of 10, apart in a separate event? What does it say?
So there's
about
a super
the system?
Bad problem with the polls, which is they're polling everybody. They're not polling people who are actually going to vote. And Donald Trump's voters are what they call low information voters. They're classically the kind of people who don't vote in primaries. So in some sense, his lead is completely, not completely, but largely artificial. And meanwhile, we've been hearing on the campaign trail, there's been a buzz about Carly Fiorina for a couple months. And so she just got to show it to a broader audience. But she's earned her way into the next calendar.
Very quick question about the Democrats. Earlier this week, Mark, a lot of reporting about whether or not Joe Biden may get into the race. There's some fairly reliable reporting that he's thinking about it, like pros, cons.
He's thinking about it. I mean, Judy, he ran for the first time in 1988. He ran in 2008. He's been vice president for 8 years. It's always been in his DNA to run for president. And Hillary Clinton's numbers in the Wall Street Journal NBC poll took a bad tumble between June and August. I mean, among women, she now has a negative rating. This was supposed to be her, you know, her golden source of support to give her the new coalition. So it has to be tempting at this point. I don't think anybody knows. I would bet that he doesn't, but it's got to be tempting if she starts to look very vulnerable.
Pros and cons.
He should not do it. He should not do it. He's a wonderful, wonderful man. He's a great public servant. This country, and especially the Democratic Party, is in the mood for systemic change and something fundamental, different. They do not want a sign of the establishment running their party. That's what she's facing. She's in a dominant position, but the tide is against her. The mood of the times are against her. The mood of the times are certainly against him. And so you got to pick your year. It's not his year. If he runs, I think he'll do some damage to his long-term reputation.
He doesn't have a lot of other years to choose, David.
Well, we'll talk about that. Yeah. Very different subject here at the end, the Iran nuclear deal. The president gave another passionate defense this week, made a speech at American University. He's had a number of Democrats come out, Mark, in favor, but he lost a big one in Senator Chuck Schumer last night. How significant is that? Is the president making any headway with this argument?
Yeah, the president is. I mean, he needs a third plus one in either the House or the Senate, one of the two. Obviously, Jewish members, including such as Chuck Schumer, are very much a target because of, understandably, Israel's opposition. 92 countries have endorsed this nuclear agreement, Judy, including Lebanon and Saudi Arabia and Iraq and Jordan, as well as United American allies, Egypt. But I mean, Algeria. But the United States here, there is a real premium on Sandy Levin of Michigan supporting it. Chuck Schumer is an important legislator. He's going to be the next Democratic leader. The fact that Kristen Gillibrand, his colleague in New York, and very close, at the same time came out in support of the president's position, may indicate that Chuck Schumer is not going to spend a lot of time, effort, energy trying to proselytize other members.
How significant is this?
Yeah, first of all, I don't think Bibi Netanyahu's opposition has anything to do with Chuck Schumer's opposition or the Israeli position has anything to do. I think it's a terrible deal, not because Israel does. I just think it's a terrible deal that will endanger the Middle East for generations to come, and I'm sure Schumer came to the same conclusion. In the public opinion, Obama's losing the argument. The latest poll I saw was 2-1 against among the American public. Mm-hmm. And frankly, I thought Obama's speech, he's a great speechmaker, he's a great arguer, certainly one of his weakest speeches, in which you're sitting on the fence, is a close issue. He says, oh, it's not a close issue. It's transparently a close issue. It's a tough debate. Second, if you were on the fence, he was insulting you in your thinking that this is, you're so stupid, you're wrong in the past.
Equating it with opposing, it was, or just going to war in Iraq.
Yeah, it was just, I found a very high-handed speech designed to offend, not to persuade.
I do think, Judy, quite frankly, that the president is making the same case that Ronald Reagan made in dealing with the Soviets, negotiating with Iran. They're not nice people, they're not good people, but it is important. And I think he's making the case.
Mark Shields, David Brooks, we thank you.